Good afternoon and a very happy new year, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sandring Astrin. I am the head of research for Credit Suisse Indonesia. It is our honor today to have His Excellency Bapak Luhut Panjaitan, Indonesia Coordinating Minister for Maritime Affairs and Investment, with us today. I think Bapak Luhut needs a little introduction himself, but for the purpose of this discussion, it is worth highlighting that Bapak Luhut is one of the foremost champions for investments and job creation in Indonesia, and often sharing his vision on Indonesia's role in electric value chain and tourism, among others. With that, I'd like to hand over to Bapak Luhut for his thoughts on the great transformation that is happening in Indonesia currently. Bapak Luhut.
Okay, thank you, Andre. Good morning, everybody. My name is Luhut Panjaitan. I would like to brief you a little bit what happened now in Indonesia beyond the pandemic, the great transformation in Indonesia, which is, I think, it happened now. So we look at Indonesia not only from the negative perspective because of this COVID-19, but we look at also that this is a good opportunity for us to reform a lot of things within the country. If you look at next slide, the COVID-19 game and infected more than 80 million people in the world until today. So this is, I think, number is very huge. And resulting of this is a global recession. If you look at this one, I think China, Indonesia, India, Vietnam, Taiwan, Singapore, European Union, US. But China, I think, is very quick to recover. So if you look at now, when the first, second quarter, I think the contraction -6.8%. But to last year, they grew already 4.9%. Indonesia, contraction the second quarter 5.3, and right now we are -3.2%. So we're trying very hard basically to recover from this problem, which is not easy because we are now facing also much a number of infected in Indonesia. But I'll tell you later on how do we tackle this one. So we're not a second wave, but we have to be careful in this. There are signs a second wave could hinder the current uptrend update, like in the US, in Europe, Southeast Asia, South Asia and Southeast Asia, and Indonesia. If you look at now Indonesia, we have already like 772,000 cases and around over 600 something recovery. So it's quite okay, 82% something recovery, but we still need to tackle this one. Now 84% of cases are from the 13 most impacted provinces, like Jakarta, Jawa Barat, East Java, Central Java. So that's, I think, now we focus with. So we have to carefully tackle this one because some area, nearly they don't have a case of COVID. You know. So because Indonesia, the largest archipelagic country, you know, 17,000 island. In small island in eastern part of Indonesia, you're not going to see COVID case over there. Although we still give them vaccine. So we vaccinate also people in the rural area. Now, therefore, COVID-19 response is focused for most affected provinces. So we have to prioritize. So upstream target reduction in daily new cases, downstream target increase in recovery rate and reduction in mortality rate. Now, at provinces like Jakarta, West Java, Central Java, North Sumatra and Bali, and additions, Riau and Aceh, we focus on this one. Our strategy, now the very important one, which is I think the target still not as good as we expected, like 60%. We like to do it like 80%, you know. Detection of COVID transmission, behavior change, that's I think very important. Some people still feel, this is not really very dangerous. But right now, they understand because number of, infected also increase. And some of these infected already hit the family. Encouraging people compliance with the health protocol, et cetera, And number two, I think the very important one is that now we realize centralized isolation facilities, which is I think we have it already in Jakarta the last 4 months, and we see the impact of this very good for us. So we're going to we build right now to discipline people to go there. That's I think very important. Before, not many people, they just do it quarantine at home, which is now we encourage them to go to the central quarantine facilities. If you look at also highly impacted the province contributed to national update that this number, if you look at this number, this is for January, yesterday. So we update number daily basis, very like 6 p.m. I will get the latest report on that day. This is a national contribution, eight provinces, the big province in Indonesia, 72% to the national. And another five provinces is 17%. So positivity rate is 15.8%. This national contribution to the eight provinces, you see the data here, you can see that this is the data that we understand. We see also the, you know, the number of cases increasing time to time. Mortality rate and recovery rate, if you look at this data, next slide, national contribution here, eight provinces are 77.8%. The five provinces like Riau, Aceh, Sumbar, Kaltim, Papua is 13.4%. So national contribution, eight provinces are 77%. This is the last chart, if you look at this one. And five provinces, 3.3%. This, I think, the status per today. Now let me move to the Indonesian need strategy to boost investment and industrialization, which is I think more and more we understand what we have to do. If you look at the background, COVID-19 pandemic impact the health, mortality rate, increasing hospital burden, impact the economy. But now, like I've told you earlier, this is a golden opportunity for us to reform. So right now we can produce our own rapid test antigen, which is the cost also lower. Used to be we have to import. And we have our own pharmaceutical industry right now. Before, we like 90% we import from any country. When the country like India lockdown, then we don't have the source of for the medicine. So today, I can tell you that we are moving quite well on this regard. Implementation of the omnibus law will simplify overlapping regulation. There's nothing to do more than that. I think how do we, you know, minimize, you know, this regulation? If you look at here, there are 8,451 central government regulation and 15,965 regulation, regional regulation that describe the complexity of regulation in Indonesia. Now we take it out. We make it simple. So when you invest in Indonesia right now, much, much different than before. Now, benefit of application of the omnibus law, if you look at this one, the slide, omnibus law as a strategic for us. Now, this is licensing of the key changes in the omnibus law. There are 11, basically. Simplification of doing business, investment requirement, manpower. You look at this one, 52 laws. There are 79 laws altogether and 1,244 articles that we make some adjustment here and there in one law. So this is breakthrough basically for Indonesia because nobody dared to do it before. And President Joko Widodo very firm. When I talked to President Joko Widodo yesterday, I think we are very happy when we look at this progress of omnibus law and also the downstream of this omnibus law. So because by law, next February, all the, you know, the presidential decree and the minister decree have to be in place. Now, simplification of licensing through risk-based method. This is also one people thought that we don't care about the environment. No, we care very much about the environment. I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen, if you look at now, we have a program like restoration, mangrove restoration for the 640,000 hectares for the next 4 years. This year, next year, and the year under 2024. So we are working very hard on this. Because we care about the environment. We care for the next generation of Indonesia. We make this one because our responsibility to the next generation of Indonesia. We are not thinking very much about the other country. Yes, we care also about that. But we care very much to our own people. So if you don't, if you make a wrong policy about the environment, the first victim is my grandchildren, not your the other country. The other country, yes. But for me, the priority is our own people. So if our own people also protected from this environment, then also other countries could enjoy this. So like high-risk government lunch is required in addition to the NAB, that we make it very tight also regulation on that. Now, environmental approval will still be needed, especially for the high-risk business. The high-risk business, they still need the environmental approval. For the law, we don't need that anymore. We just check it. But implication of that, basically, if they break a law, then we can revocation of the business permit. This is a thing they should understand that. Omnibus law and then establishment of Indonesian Sovereign Wealth Fund, I think is very important for Indonesia. This is part of the omnibus law. So when we discuss about Sovereign Wealth Fund, and at the same time we are talking about the omnibus law, then I advise to the president, maybe we can put also Sovereign Wealth Fund part of the omnibus law. So then we work very hard that to do so, then we are happy so far that we are successful to do so. So I asked one of my staff, Hernando, to be part of the team. Basically, we are the initiated this program, and he can explain to you about this because he very detailed discussed this with Adia from Abu Dhabi, JBIC, and also with the IDFC. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. So if you see the sovereign wealth fund is established through the omnibus law. So if you see our law, there are two things that you can see in our law. First, independency, and then second is professionalism. So how do we do that through our law? So you can see established by Indonesian law as a sui generis Indonesian legal entity. It means it's separated. So the management, so the budget of the sovereign wealth fund is separated from the state budget, which allow the sovereign wealth fund to be managed professionally, taking a professional decision. If it has three mandates, the first one is asset optimization through corporate actions. So through the sovereign wealth fund, we also expect that we can recycle our assets. By doing this, we expect to reduce our debt to our state-owned enterprise. The second one, we want to attract investment by co-investing with both overseas and local partners. So investors can come in, then we have several thematic funds. We will explain to you the structure after this. And then the third one is to play active role in improving Indonesian investment climate. This is also what we want by having outside investors to invest in our assets. It can bring more transparent and professional to the asset itself, because now its assets need to be have liability to the investors. Nah, then the management of the entity in maturity is professional. We also establish this in the law. We have two tier boards in there. We have the first one is supervisory board, and then the board of directors. In the supervisory board, two ministers are there: the minister of state-owned enterprise, and then the minister of finance. But then the other three is all professionals. By doing this, we want the professionals to have more influence in the supervisory board. And then all the board of directors will be appointed by the supervisory board that are all professionals. This is in the sovereign wealth fund part. But then in the fund part itself, as you can see in the structure of service, it will be managed by the professional fund managers. So we have two tiers here. And then if you see also the second one, the asset management activity, it will involve transfer of asset, dissolution of asset. And then this is the cooperation with the third party by establishing fund and sub-fund. The type of investment includes public and private equity, project financing, debt instruments. It's also allowed in our law. And then also the sectors will be include the key sectors of Indonesian economy. The first one, that in the first phase, we will offer the investors the infrastructure fund. toll roads, seaports, and airports. This is our crown jewel. Many of the investors that we already discussed is very interested in these three parts. For example, if you talk about airports, our Soekarno-Hatta, we plan to have the next terminal. This is also the investors. Besides, they want to be the financial investors. They also want to be strategic investors there for the management of the airport itself. The geography, domestic in its inception with the possibility to go overseas. So if we also open the possibility that having the jurisdiction outside Indonesia. Next. This is the structure of the fund. So this is the Indonesian government, and you can see the Indonesian Sovereign Wealth Fund, but the investor will invest in the master fund, not in the Sovereign Wealth Fund itself. Both of them can be the LP of the master fund, and then we have the master fund manager of the master fund. After the master fund, we can inject all the capital to the thematic fund. We have several: infrastructure, energy, health, tourism, technology, and then the new capital. We also open options for the investors also to inject directly to the assets. How the scheme work, we still find the balance between the master fund and then directly to the asset itself. But by doing this, we expect to expand our asset. We can get more recycled assets, so we can develop. So the SOE itself, they can get fresh capital to develop new projects. So for the current scheme, two government regulations for LPA has been passed. The first one is the injection of the capital, 15 trillion rupiah. And then the second one is about the governance of the LPA itself. So because we have discussed this in close with ADIA, the Abu Dhabi, you can see in our law and our government regulation actually is pretty detailed, almost to the level of operational activity, which is actually should be included in the SOP of the fund, of the fund, not in the level of the law or government regulation. But we realize that this kind of quite operational is what investors need to provide the investor with the certainty. Yeah, I think that's all.
Okay. This is the thing about the Sovereign Wealth Fund. We're going to have a meeting about the Sovereign Wealth Fund with ADIA. I think ADIA organized this meeting middle of
akhir bulan January.
End of this January. So this ADIA could sponsor the meeting and virtual meeting. I think inviting so many participants in this virtual meeting. Now investment focus to generate big bang for the back and health sector, downstream natural resources, and AP battery development and green economy. This is, I think, we are leading in this particular area. So we are focused on that right now. Like EV battery development, we are doing very well on that. I can give you one example, like nickel focused downstream policy has borne fruit, jump in iron and steel export. If you look at this data in 2018, 19, and 2020. Iron steel, before we just export the raw material, nickel ore. But today we don't want to do that anymore. We like to see the value added for any resources that we have in Indonesia, which is Indonesia also very rich on the national resources. So we'll see this one create a job opportunity, value added, and type of technology, education, tax, so many things that we can get from that. So iron steel export surpassed vehicle export in like $11 billion. This is the data again. If you look at before 2014, iron steel still, much bigger carbon. I think vehicle already stuck in this, or maybe they can go up a little bit. But this one, iron and steel, we still can go higher. So this helps also our GDP, our GDP deficit. Now, if you look at also the next slide, this is after focusing on nickel processing to stainless steel, Indonesia has opportunity to process nickel to lithium battery component. This is ongoing. It's not only planned, this is ongoing. So before we just a nickel ore here, now we are heading toward this nickel alloy, chemical battery, stainless steel battery. This is, I think, our target in the within 2-3 years time. Now, mapping of mineral downstream of EV development. If you look at next slide, we'll see this one. That we like to see the so downstream industry on this. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are the biggest nickel ore reserve in the world. High grade and low grade. High grade and low grade. So with the electricity cost like 5 cents per kilowatt hour, like in the Morowali or in Beda Bay, and also the transportation cost lower, then I believe nobody can beat us in terms of cost. So transportation cost, if you transfer it to China, for instance, from Indonesia, it costs you like $10. While in that island, the same island, Sulawesi or Halmahera, your cost may be only $1 or so. Now, Indonesia has enough resources to become a key player in the EV battery industry. If you look at the next slide, yeah, okay, if you compare Indonesia to Australia, yes, Australia has a bigger reserve, but the cost is higher because the nickel ore in the middle of a continent. EV battery increasingly need the nickel. If you look at this data, we are heading toward the 811 and MG 811. That's something we're going to produce by 2023. This is the NIP, the type NMC, NMC 811. This, I think, the latest technology that we are, NM 811. 811, yeah, this one. Now, prospective partners in EV battery ecosystem development, LG and CATL. If you look at next slide, full end-to-end in line with the government, mostly aligned with the government need, government and need more discussion in charging station. This is the, but with CATL, nearly done. Yeah. So we're going to have one industry integrated between the Freeport and Freeport and Tsingshan in Weda Bay for you know, smelter for copper. But next to that, we have nickel ore smelter. This is Tsingshan with the CATL. So basically, we can see the production by end of 2023. We can produce the lithium battery from Indonesia. That's, I think, situation in Indonesia today. And to all of you, ladies and gentlemen, we are very welcome. If you want to invest in Indonesia, do something in Indonesia. Again, we care about the environment. We care also about regulation right now. And we have abundance of resources in this country. And I think the process to invest in Indonesia much easier, and also leadership of President Joko Widodo, I think, is a good example for us. Used to be the, you know, some of the leader has their own business in within the government. Today, I think it's very hard to see this one. There's some corruption still there and here, but I think much less and less because we established system better and better today. That's my presentation. I hope that you can get some input from our presentation. And I'm more than happy if you want to ask any question to us. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you do wish to ask a question, please do send to that email that you can see below the screen. Thank you so much, Bapak Luhut, for your very clear presentation. It is very encouraging to hear the changes that's happening. Maybe, Pak Luhut, if I can start off with a question. You know, it is really exciting to hear about more investment in battery value chain. You mentioned on your slides, LG Chem and CATL. Just wondering, in your view, are there any more that might invest? Not just nickel to not just limonite ore processing, but also with regards to the full battery manufacturing. Are there such as automakers that might commit to it? Could you comment more on that?
I I think Andre quite a lot, yeah. Like air products and like you know, Adam Forrest from Australia, and I was in Saudi Arabia in Riyadh last month. Also, like quite many company want to invest in Indonesia. From US also, they're talking about lithium battery also. We have a quite intensive communication with them right now. Yeah, so I think quite a lot, you know, like pension funds also, they want to be part of our sovereign wealth fund, like Pacific pension fund, yeah, Pacific.
Yeah,
PIF, so quite many. And I'm pretty confident that we can see a lot of progress in this country within this coming month. So especially with the program of vaccinate from the Indonesia, because we begin the vaccination this coming 14th of January, and we're going to vaccinate for the whole year, like 181 million. And we have already 426 million dosage, and so basically this program is good, you know. So then we can maintain, or we can contain, or we clean, or we take care COVID-19, and at the same time we believe that we can move forward, yeah. So because I think China also is a good model, because they invest like $600 billion this year for the stimulus program, which is, I think, good for like Indonesia to export some of the material that they needed. At the same time, we are working also for the agriculture, which is, I think, very important. Before, we don't have food estate, but now we have four food estate. You know, in Lake Toba, we have like 30,000 hectares. In also in Central Kalimantan, we have like few hundred thousand hectares. And and then also in Lumajang, and as well as in NTT. So basically, we focus this one. This again because of the COVID-19. So we don't want to depend on other countries while we can do it domestically. It doesn't mean that we don't open. We open, but we have to take care of ourselves also. If something happened with that country, like we experienced with the lockdown of India, then hurting us, people of Indonesia, very much. So then, since then, we learned we have to do something for our own benefit. So food estate, like in Lake Toba, 30,000, we focus on horticultura. So like onion, like garlic, like potatoes, something like that. While this one, like 1,400 meters above sea level, I think based on the expert report, the quality of soil over there is the first class.
Wow. That's very encouraging, especially on self-sufficiency, Pak Luhut. That's where we are going at. Definitely would like to talk more about the vaccination, Pak Luhut. But if I can just touch upon battery or electric vehicle. In your view, right, there is a thought process from some of the auto investors with regards to there is a need for a domestic volume first. And one key bottleneck of that is the absence of incentives at the moment at the downstream side and investment in the charging station infrastructure, for example. And understand there is a general plan for the local state-owned enterprises to develop that. Any thoughts on that? Any wishes that you have that we may in future incentivize, provide tax incentives or whatnot for the development of the domestic EV industry?
Yes, absolutely. You know, otherwise, you know, it's not very competitive. You know, if you the tax to the fossil car and to electric cars, same, it's not good. So we have to give incentive. I think if my understanding, like 12% down, yeah. How do you call it? Zero tax for the electric vehicle. Yeah, so make it very competitive. For this is, I think, the government policy. The presidential decree, I think, We're going to issue anytime this month because electric vehicle in Hyundai built one factory in near mana? Krawang. This is already 80%. So next July and June, May, June, July, they're going to produce. And I went there like last November, it was 60%. So then we have to issue this regulation. Otherwise, you're not going to compete with the fossil car.
That's great to hear. What about potential investments in the potential charging stations? In your view, will it be accelerated? There is a blueprint that was published, I believe, in 2018. Will that be accelerated, you think?
Station, I think on the this is very important, and we work it together with PLN, Pertamina, BPPT, and who else? These I think three institutions ongoing right now. They produce two type of charges. One the Asia model, and also another one the Europe model. If I'm not mistaken, something like that. So we're going to have this one, and I think we focus on Jakarta. And let me, Andre, put it something. State budget 2021, we can we have to buy a vehicle, electric vehicle, as well as a motorbike and public transportation. This is, I think, encourage public that the government are already heading toward that direction.
Wow. The policies and the budget spending is very clear towards developing that. Thanks for that. There is a question on vaccination program, and you mentioned earlier on 14 January starting date, right? Wondering, you mentioned also a 180 million, correct me if I'm wrong on the numbers, of vaccination. Just wondering, in terms of the timeline, will most of the vaccination be done in first half or second half, or has the supply been secured? If you could elaborate, just to confirm that this is mostly Sinovac.
I think source of vaccine already secure, and just get message just now that 15 million will arrive also. Let me see the text. Yeah, this is very quick, Andre. Uh-huh. Well, we get already approved another 15 million will arrive in Indonesia this coming week. And so the process in the biopharma. So we hope that we can, continue vaccinate like next month around 15 million people. So this month maybe around 3 million. Which is, I think, good lah. First month, we have to learn how to do it, instead of doing massively, and then we get a problem. So we'll do it now only 3 million. Hopefully next month, we can do it 50 million. And then the next month, the following month, maybe we can go up over 50 million, 20 million. Because our capability basically to up to 27.5 million a month. So that's, I think, that our capability. So then we can vaccine like 181 million people until end of this year, which is, I think, a big, big operation for us.
Got it. So optimize first at a small scale. Once it's optimized, scale it up. Just to test it out first. Got it. That's the
we, Andre, we have also Sinovac. We have confirmed also Pfizer, also, AstraZeneca, as well as Sinopharm. Sinopharm is talking about something like not yet done, not the, the efficacy, but we are talking about some, business, the rate of this, Sinopharm. We don't want to see the too much different with the Sinovac, AstraZeneca, and Pfizer. But I think we have more than enough right now. Like I mentioned, 26 million. Till 2022, yeah.
Got it. That's right. That's a big relief. Myself, being in Indonesia, living in Jakarta, that's a big relief.
Yeah.
We have another question with regards to the sovereign wealth fund, Pak Luhut. It's, you know, which are the key areas of investment that's prioritized? If I refer to your slides, it's looking like infrastructure, but just wondering your immediate thoughts on this in the next couple of months.
Well, there are some other. I think Nando can explain. I think that the toll road, sea road, the airport. Toll road, airport, seaport. That's, I think, the first batch. Detail, Nando can explain that.
Yeah, so for the toll road, it will include the Trans-Java toll road, and then maybe we also bundle with some of other toll roads. Some of them is greenfield and some is brownfield, so we can package them together. The second one, airports, as I mentioned before, it's going to be the Soekarno-Hatta Airport. The third one is the seaport. If you see about the capacity, actually, we will combine all our ports together. So it's, if combined, it should be around 8 or 9 largest in the world based on the capacity itself.
Yeah, I think, Andre, let me add to you, you know, our containers like 18 million TEUs a year. 18. So if you combine all together, it's going to be, you know, 8 largest, biggest seaport in the world. That's number one. Number two, we can reduce the cost like 30% because we can make direct call. We don't need to go to Singapore anymore. Maybe some still, but most of these we can make it direct call. So basically, Andre, yeah. Because of this COVID, we make so many restructuring, you know, to make this country this more efficient. More yeah. efficient. So we understand, like airport, seaport, like you know, like Cengkareng and Bali. Why don't we do yes. this? Make it a professional, you know, professional thing to manage this one. I think can go up, maybe increase the. Now valuation 30%.
Wow.
Because of efficiency. Yeah, similar also to seaport. Study done by the Bappenas, they said they can go efficiency to 40% something. Okay, let's discount lah. Give 30%, 25%, that's a lot.
Wow. It's great, yeah. It's also changing the culture in order to essentially cost optimize for most of the government bodies. So that's very encouraging to hear, Pak Luhut. There is another question with regards to, many of us in the investment world rejoice when the Omnibus Law was signed. You know, it is, it's a product of the commitment of the Indonesian government towards attracting investments. In your own view, are there any further laws, that can help Indonesia in this great transformation towards economic competitiveness? There is an upcoming omnibus tax law, but are there more changes that you wish to see that can help Indonesia investment?
You're asking about the tax, yeah?
Tax, and if there's any further laws that you think may be amended in order to...
Oh, yes. Yeah. This is, I think, part of the government program to make some, relaxation on the tax law. So basically, we like to do it similar to other countries. So making us become more competitive. Megan, Nando want to add it.
Yeah, so for the government regulation about the tax, we're still in discussion, but actually there will be some relaxation, like let's say the capital gain tax, etc. And then also the rate, we will also compare it and with other countries, so investors can also invest and go into Indonesia, knowing that we have a good tax regime, but then it's still under discussion.
Got it. Thank you for that. Also, just I want to get your general thoughts on the potential long-term partnerships with the different countries. We know there's a couple of government changes happening across the world, and for a long time, the partnership in Asia has been strengthened through further investments from China over here. How do you think about balancing all these various investment interests? We want to work for obviously Indonesia's benefit and the Indonesian citizens' benefit. What are your concerns? Are there concerns there? Are there excitements that you wish to see from another country to join investment in Indonesia? Just your general thoughts on it.
We're friend with any countries, Andre, you know. So yeah, as long as benefit Indonesia, benefit our partner, we'll do this, you know. So our relation with China, very, very good. With the U.S. also, I think very good. With Japan, with Abu Dhabi, with Riyadh. So for us, this is, I think, our constitution, that we have to establish a good relation to any countries and benefit both both side, yeah. So I don't see any problem. See, like the China and U.S., maybe Indonesia can be honest broker for this, you know, because we don't have problem with both countries, you know. In a way, it's very good. South China Sea issue, but for us, look at also as a challenge, you know. How do we maintain stability in this region? Indonesia can play the, you know, very vital role. I think you are aware of the size of Indonesia, 273 million. And our GDP over $1 trillion, and we are very rich, abundant of national resources. I think so. This country is not a banana republic, so we can play our role very significantly to make or to bring prosperity and to bring also stability in this region. So we're not gonna lean toward any country. We are too big to lean to any superpower. So that's, I think, a very clear statement from Indonesia.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, that's a great statement to have, Paluhut. I guess if you can talk more about your desire for Indonesia to be within the healthcare champion. I mean, one thing is for self-sufficiency. What are the key lacks at the moment that we need to improve? How realistic can we achieve this what medical healthcare.
Yeah, healthcare, Andre, like I mentioned, earlier, is very, very important for us, you know, to be, you know, to have the, our own. You know, let's say maybe 70 to 80% have to make it locally, you know. So we invite investor to invest in Indonesia. We learn from, you know, from this, you know, from last year experience of the COVID-19. So even the basic medicine like, apa namanya itu?
Paracetamol.
We don't have paracetamol in Indonesia. But then we understand that we have petrochemical in Cilacap. So we can produce, now we produce our paracetamol. Can you imagine such a big country like Indonesia, very basic medicine, we don't have paracetamol. Now we have the paracetamol. Even when we build right now in Kalimantan, Pertamina, Adia, what's the name, the Balikpapan, with the Mubadala, one of the target have to also produce a basic medicine for us, like paracetamol, some others also. So this is also an opportunity to all of you, if you want to invest on the pharmaceutical, still a big room to move, a big room. ASEAN has population like 620 million, out of that like 40% more, this is Indonesia. So some people thought that Indonesia is a small country. No, no. If you look at now to other countries surrounding us, when we lock down us, then they're suffering also. But the last 10 months, we're still okay because 75 to 80% domestic consumption in Indonesia make our economy still moving, although not very fast, but still maintain can be, you know, around 0% or so. But we hope that this year we can go up maybe 4 or 5%. That's, I think, what happened in Indonesia today. So
Some people thought that we are, you know, they can dictate us. No, nobody can dictate us. We are big enough to say something, but of course we have to maintain also relation to other countries. But nobody can dictate us. Thought that Indonesia can be dictated by other country because they are rich. Yeah, they're rich. But we are also very rich. We are not a poor country, no. We just manage. When we manage this well, this country is going to be much, much better in the years to come. That's your generation also, Andre. You can see Indonesia 10 years from now, much better than today. If we manage like this, like Nando. Nando is a young guy. He's also a plan. He also arranged. He also set up strategy. How do we do? How do we deal with this? You know. So people are working with heart. Different than before. Much different.
I mean, you know, you're absolutely right, Pak Luhut. Even as we observe the last 6 years, it's a massive transformation, massive change in policy and also in culture. So just want to, really want to show the appreciation. And hopefully there's many more Indonesians that's willing to come back here as well. One last thing from me. Is there any call of action that you'd like to share to investors at the moment? Seems that Indonesia is becoming a very promising place to invest. If you want to do that closing words.
Andre, we've been discussing minute one about why you should go to invest in Indonesia, because we have everything here. We have everything here with the new program of government disharmonization, with omnibus law, it's a breakthrough. Then we are abundant of natural resources, and the spirit also want to improve. I think it's the best place to go. I don't know if I still remember when I was Minister of Industry and Trade back to the year 2000, 2001, they keep telling, well, Indonesia is going to be this and that. There's nothing happened today. We are still Indonesia. They're talking about some problem here and there. Yes, but it's still here, improving. How can you say that you don't have a problem, Such a big country like Indonesia, diverse country, 17,000 islands. But we are able and we manage all the problem pretty well. That's, I think, our experience. When I was active in the military, people talking about Papua, it happened like this. But we solve it. Yeah, today, more transparent, much better. The president gave a good example. Yeah. No business at all within the inner circle of the president, even the president himself. So that's, I think, the very important part. The leader gives the good example. If you don't give a good example, Andre, it's not going to work. I cannot talk like this openly if I'm doing something behind me. No. Nando can understand that I'm doing something conflict of interest behind me. No, I don't want to, because I want to give the good example to the young generation of Indonesia. Hey, let's do it for the benefit of your generation. Not my generation. My generation is the old generation. But I'm talking for my children, or the children of Indonesia, and the young generation of Indonesia. That's the objective. So this is the golden opportunity for you to invest, anybody to invest in Indonesia, even America. I cannot disclose yet the name of the bigger company. We have already very intense communication, because they understand. After I explained, did you know that the size of Indonesia like this, like 7 hours flying time from the Merauke to Sabang? Not many Western people understand. They thought like only, small country. I said, no, this is a big country. So, Andre, you have to be proud to be Indonesian. Hopefully, you're still Indonesian.
I'm still Pak Luhut. And I find your speech always very inspiring. And I just want to thank you for sharing the wisdom and knowledge. We hope we can host you again in future. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the session. I would like to thank Bapak Luhut, Pak Nando, and the Menko Maritim team for being here. Please join us later at 1 p.m. Hong Kong time for the next session on e-payments. Can ASEAN transform into a cashless society? Thank you very much. and I wish you all a good day.